strong and prosper.
I was going into Toshi Station to pick up some power converters.
Lilu Dallas Multipass.
Shut up and take my money.
By Grabthar's hammer. What a saving.
One does not simply walk into Mordor.
X never, ever marks the spot.
Winter is coming.
You're a wizard, Harry.
Stay a while and listen.
Hey, old Kermit the Frog here.
Your ties are cold.
So say we all.
This is a Play on Nerds.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to episode 74 of A Play on Nerds. I am one of your lovely co-hosts, Jarman.
And I'm one of the ugly co-hosts, Steve.
Don't call yourself ugly. You're lovely. You're wonderful.
And we're happy to have you back with us. What are we talking about today, Jarman?
Today, we are going with our ongoing series of reviewing, alternatingly, Star Trek and Muppet movies, the whole franchises. And this week, we're doing Muppets Take Manhattan, the third movie in the Muppet franchise of films. And who do we have as a special guest to help us review this film?
Today with us, we have Joe and Ryan from ToughPigs.com, a community for Muppet fans who grew up. These guys are experts as far as I'm concerned. I feel like I've got a depth of knowledge and you'll hear it. We did an extensive interview with them. And because of that, we're going to be cutting nerdy news this week. And I'm sorry about that, but this interview was great, but it ended up being longer, I think, we expected, but I loved it.
It's fantastic. And for any fandom you think you're a fan of, these guys will test your limits because they are the complete experts in their fandom.
They really are. It's super impressive, even for me.
Together again. Gee, it's good to be together again.
So please enjoy as we interview Joe Hens and Ryan Rowe from ToughPigs.com in our review of Muppets Take Manhattan.
It's just going hard. Together up. Together up.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, now we have some very special guests with us. We have Ryan and Joe from ToughPigs.com, a Muppet fandom site for fans who grew up.
Hey.
Hello.
And we are so excited to have them here with us to discuss The Muppets Take Manhattan. Welcome, guys.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's great to be here. It's always good to talk about Muppets.
Yes, always.
Like constantly.
Yeah, all the time. Can you guys tell us a little bit about your website and what that's all about?
Yeah. So ToughPigs.com, we say it's a fan for adult age fans of The Muppets, Sesame Street, and the life and legacy of Jim Henson. The site's been around since 2001. Ryan and I have been running it since 2007.
Yeah.
Wow. So yeah, we just passed our 10-year anniversary of writing about Muppets every single day, which is insane.
That's amazing.
And basically we like to write, do mostly commentaries and reviews and interviews and fun things like art and videos and stuff like that, with kind of a really honest, often snarky voice to kind of keep things interesting and to let people know, as much as we love Muppets, and we do, that not everything is good, and that's okay.
That's all right. You accept the good with the bad.
We like to think it's for the older, more sophisticated, discriminating Muppet fans.
That's right. The pipe smoking, jacket wearing Muppet.
Right. A picture Cookie Monster doing masterpiece theater on Sesame Street. Smoking jacket, nice chair. Highbrow literature.
Yes.
That's us.
And cookies.
On our podcast, basically, I'm the huge Star Trek fan and Steve is the huge Muppet fan. And I listen to a lot of Star Trek podcasts and I'll be on some too. And we'll realize we go a whole episode like bashing a Star Trek episode. And we realize we still love Star Trek and every episode of Star Trek. It's just that, we're doing a podcast about it, for God's sakes. But we just like, nitpicking it and having fun with it, so it's out of love.
Yeah, well, that's part of the fun. And sometimes there are new Muppet productions and even old Muppet productions that we can't stand and we do nothing but insult them. But it's still like, if it comes out on DVD in a new edition, we're going to buy it.
That's absolutely true.
Like, what are we going to do? Not be a fan of the thing.
And it's also the one big thing that the Muppets and Star Trek have in common is they've both been around for 50 plus years.
Yeah.
And so with that much content, like, you're going to have the great, but you're also going to have the embarrassingly bad.
Absolutely.
Like the so bad it's good again,
It's like the Star Wars holiday special equivalent, you know.
That's exactly it. Yeah. Although I don't know if that one's really that redeemable. Except for Bea Arthur. She's great. Yes.
She is. That is the best part of that. You're absolutely correct.
This past Christmas, we just did a watch along with that where we played the holiday special while we commented on it, Mystery Science Theater 3000 style. And it was,
oh man,
it was painful. Really the painful. Best way to do it.
It was really
painful. Yeah. Well, the last time we watched it, you and me, Ryan, we did it with the riff tracks.
Yeah.
And it was tough.
It was still
tough to get through.
Yeah. Yeah. Bea Arthur musical and then the animated part in the middle with Boba Fett are the only two redeemable parts.
Boba Fett.
Yeah. I love that. It's
the highlight.
It's the hour and a half of celebrating Life Day on Keshek that I can't do that. That's my brain fell right out of my ear.
And this old man actor I did not recognize at all. Like, he was just so boring.
Yeah. Well, my question throughout the whole thing was, how many more things are they going to watch a video on? I feel like there are 12 pieces of electronics and each one they watch something on.
That's pretty much what it is. It's just one sequence after another I guess that's what Wookiees do.
Wow. Well, thank you for having us on your Star Wars podcast.
Yeah.
Welcome. And we're also not afraid to get off topic here.
So. Oh, absolutely. One of the things I've asked Stephen before, but I want to ask you guys, how did you guys first get into the Muppets and why do you think you're so in love with it to this day?
I think I first got into the Muppets from watching Sesame Street, which was the first thing I ever watched on TV.
Wow.
So I guess some people eventually grow out of Muppets and Sesame Street and all that. And maybe I did for a few years, like in my early teens when I was trying to be really cool. But otherwise, yeah, I just, it's all such good stuff. And there's so much of it that I just stuck with it.
Yeah, I have a similar story. And I think most Muppet fans would have a similar story of like, you watch Sesame Street, you fall in love with it. You never really lose it, but you graduate from Sesame Street to the Muppet Show, to the movies, to the Jim Henson projects, and so on and so on and so on. And, you know, I've always been obsessed to a point. I'll use the word obsessed, even though it kind of gets a bad rap. But I guess anyone who runs a Muppet fan site can consider themselves
own
obsessed.
Your obsession.
Yes,
but it wasn't. I moved to New York about 12 years ago from Cleveland, and Ryan a couple years later from San Antonio, right?
Yes.
And I can't speak to San Antonio. I can assume that, like Cleveland, if there were Muppet fanatics, we didn't know where to find them.
Right.
You know, thankfully we had this online community already. And then when I moved to New York and actually getting to spend time with some of these people in person and becoming real friends with them, and then having the opportunity to start, you know, writing for this website, kind of pushed things into a, you know, I don't even know what a level beyond obsession is.
Yeah, I guess the internet, and this is the same for all areas of fandom, but yeah, the internet was a very big deal, and sort of you realize that there are all these other people who also, you know who all the puppeteers are, and they've watched the movies 100 times, and yeah, so that definitely helps you to hold on to the Muppet geekiness,
right? And to know that we're not alone, which is I mean, you know, important for no matter what you're interested or passionate about.
Absolutely.
Was it the same for your path, Steve?
Oh, I mean, they're telling my story right now.
Well, it's similar to my Star Trek story, too. It's like I wanted to hide this obsession because it was a little embarrassing. But as the internet grew bigger and there were more conventions, I'm like, I'm not alone. I'm not the only sociable person who likes Star Trek.
Yeah, but the difference here is Star Trek, you guys already had your conventions.
Yeah, that's true. You, Muppet.
See, what we do is so much more niche. And, you know, it's hard to find those super fans that are like us. You know, this casual fans are easy. And, you know, a lot of them will find our site eventually, but not as many of them will, you know, check in with us every single day.
There are a lot of people out there who like Mr. Snuffleupagus, but not that many who know how to spell Snuffleupagus.
Ah, well said. Yeah.
That's true. All right. So big important question for each of you. What is your favorite Muppet anything?
Everyone always goes straight to that question. What's your favorite Muppet?
That's because it's going to qualify for me what kind of Muppet fans you are.
Oh, wait, you said Muppet anything, like Muppet thing, not necessarily which
production.
Muppet.
It can be a record you loved. It could be TV, movie, Muppet, anything. Your favorite Muppet, whatever.
You literally just asked us, what's your favorite noun?
Yeah.
How do you narrow that down?
I know. That's why I told you it was a big, tough question.
Because
it might be easier to answer, what's your favorite noun?
No, I'll tell you mine. Mine is Muppet Family Christmas.
Well, yeah, that's a good choice. It's a perfect production.
Without a doubt, that is my favorite Muppet thing of all time.
It's a really good option. Now, I do want to talk about favorite Muppet things and productions and stuff. But Ryan, you have a theory for us super geeks about favorite Muppets.
Ooh.
Oh, well, you're talking about the article series.
I
wrote this article series on our website a few years ago where I realized that it was so difficult for me to name my favorite Muppet character that I might as well just say that I had a different favorite Muppet every day. Right. So every day for a week, I just kind of like woke up and thought, who's my favorite Muppet today? And then I would write an article that day about why.
Ryan, who's your favorite Muppet today? I'll put you on the spot. I know.
Yeah. Today, right. I'm kind of thinking Beaker.
That's a good one.
That's a good one.
Yeah. I'm feeling Shaky Sanchez.
Oh, that's a good one.
Yeah.
Nobody knows who that is.
No, but you know what? Look him up on the Muppet Wiki. He's pretty great.
Well, I was tempted to say Banana Nose Maldonado, but even fewer people know who that is.
Steve, do you know who that is? Do you know Banana Nose Maldonado?
I would probably know if I saw, but no, not by name.
Yeah. Do you know how he got his name, Banana Nose Maldonado?
It's because he got a banana nose.
What? No, it's because his parents are Mr. and Mrs. Maldonado.
It's from a Bear on Patrol sketch on The Muppet Show.
Wow.
What's the little twerp's name?
Banana Nose Maldonado.
Banana Nose Maldonado. How'd you ever get a dumb name like that?
My parents were Mr. and Mrs. Maldonado.
Okay, smarty poo. Lock him up, Patrol Bear.
Sorry, we went obscure there. Sorry.
Yeah, it's a deep cut. We do, by the way.
That is what we do. So my favorite Muppet thing, though, that's a Muppet Family Christmas is a good, it's a really good one because it really has everything. That's like saying, I don't know, your favorite kind of ice cream is the Vermonster.
Right. No, you're absolutely right, because you get Fraggle Rock, you get Sesame Street, you get everything in there.
Right. I mean, you could say, like, my favorite Muppet thing is The Muppet Show, but I think that would be cheating without naming one episode.
Well, what's your favorite episode of The Muppet Show, then?
Oh, man.
I know.
Okay,
well, I know you're doing a huge review series on this. Right.
So I think somebody asked us once to make our, like, top
we did,
five
yeah.
episode list.
Yeah, we end up, I think we ended up picking one from each season just to kind of play fair.
Spread
but
it out
like,
a little
know,
bit.
I mean, some of our favorites.
Pearl Bailey.
Pearl Bailey's a great one.
John Cleese.
Well, it was just Harry Belafonte's birthday. Belafonte, I was thinking about that one recently.
Harry Belafonte's is absolutely brilliant.
It's amazing. An amazing half hour of television.
I mean, Turn the World
Roy
Around
Clark
itself.
Is actually a really good one.
I love the Roy Clark episode. It's such a predecessor to Hee Haw, but it's
there's
great.
Not really a gimmick or like a one big significant moment in it.
Wait, so how old are you guys talking about Hee Haw over here?
Old enough.
Oh, man.
For me, I'd probably say Alice Cooper.
That's great.
Yeah,
that's
love it.
Paul Simon and Brooke Shields. Yeah. And mostly the Brooke Shields one. She wasn't that great, but I love the Alice.
Yeah, the Alice in Wonderland episode.
The whole Alice overall theme really carried the whole episode.
Brooke Shields, the youngest Muppet Show guest star.
Ah. Yeah. Also appeared in Muppets Take Manhattan.
It's true.
Yes.
She dates a lot of rats.
Damn, you beat us to it. And one final question, and I fully expect you. We asked this as a trivia question to our listeners two episodes ago, and nobody got it, but I fully expect you guys to get it. Can you guys tell me the name of the trumpet player in Dr. Teeth and Electric Mayhem?
Yeah. Lips.
Lips.
And who played him?
Steve Whitmire.
Yeah, of course.
And why was he created?
Why was he created?
Because Steve Whitmire was added to the Muppet troupe later in the series, and they wanted a band member for him.
Yep. Okay. These guys are fully qualified as Muppet experts,
or a new character.
Well, but here's the thing. Yeah, you asked who the trumpet player was, and I'm sure Ryan and I both thought for a second
the trumpet
which
player.
One because there's two.
Well, yes, in the orchestra.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. Which I guess is not technically the
we're right. Thing, they show up in the
really
pit, but they're not
name.
In the greater.
Right.
Dr. T.
There's just a trumpet, like a purple trumpet playing lady.
I think that's her name is like trumpet playing girl.
Yeah.
Trumpet player.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, you'll see her. If you ever watch like the first season of The Muppet Show, you'll see her down in the orchestra.
Yep.
Lips is the man. I love it. And Lips, yeah. Lips, who made
for all of our guests listening, I can now tell you to listen to these gentlemen. They know exactly what they're talking about. They belong here.
Both of us own the Lips action figure.
That's true. Yeah.
What?
Well, and what's funny is, like, just a minute ago we were dropping Banana Nose Maldonado.
Yeah.
Now, like, Lips, that's child's play to us.
I know. And this is what I try to explain, because I consider myself a Muppet aficionado, and I know more about it than anyone else I personally know. But when I knew that we were going to get you on the show, I was very intimidated, because I know that your guys' depth of knowledge. It's just superior to mine. It just is. And that's okay.
Which is interesting to me is, like, a lot of people will ask me, like, when they find out this weird thing about me that I run this Muppet fan site. One of the first things they usually ask is, like, well, you probably know more about Muppets than anyone. And it's like, well, I know more about Muppets than 99% of people out there. But the thing is, the truth is that there are people out there who it's just the way their brains work, where they just know every single detail. They, you know, like we were just talking to someone on our forum the other day who was talking about, well, the difference between the Kermit puppet in the first half of the first season and the second half of the first season.
The first two episodes of the Muppet Show were. Like, they shot part of it, and then they went back later in the season and reshot parts of it. And, yeah, this one friend of ours had figured out which shots was, a different Kermit puppet,
or which
shots were lit differently.
Right.
So that's even further beyond.
Right, and that's what I'm talking about. It's like, people, again, just the way their brains work, and you know, it's not a complaints or anything like that. But the truth is, we don't know as much as... we don't know more than the people who know the most. Like, there are people in our community who know a lot more than us. But... we write about the Muppets. We research more about the Muppets than probably anyone out there.
You are consistently bathing in Muppets.
That's right. Yes, it is. It has taken over this weird part of our lives that, you know, now it's our, you know, part-time jobs, really.
Yeah. I mean, the presence that you guys have on Facebook and the content that you guys produce, even the short time that I've been watching, is impressive, to say the very least.
Thank you.
Well, thank you. Yeah.
I was just going to say, somebody at Joe's wedding asked me if I thought that he and I are among the 100 most knowledgeable Muppet fans in the world, I guess. And I had to think about it, but I was like,
maybe.
Yeah, probably.
Yeah. I mean, if you take away like the people who actually work for the Muppets.
Oh, yeah.
True. Yeah. And people that have written books about them, probably.
Well, which again, that's only a handful of people. So.
Yeah.
So we might be in the top 100. Actually, I'd be pretty confident to say that, yes, we are in the top 100.
Yeah.
I'm confident in saying that you guys are the top 100, and then I'm top 200. I'm that next tier down.
Yeah.
You know, that's a good place to be, though. Like,
that's right.
And it's not a competition. You know, we all love it. We all love this stuff. You know?
Yeah. There are also worse things to be knowledgeable about.
But I'm not afraid to say you're superior nerds to me. That's okay. That's all right.
Well, we're proud of it.
Well, and also on most nerd subjects, you go to a convention, you talk to people on the cast and crew, and you probably know more than most of them, too. So let's be honest.
That definitely happens.
We have been told by certain people, certain puppeteers whose names you might recognize, that you sometimes don't know what's going on until they go to our website and they say, oh, I guess that's what we're working on.
I guess I'm going to have a job soon.
Yes.
That's hilarious.
It's okay. I work for Apple, and with all the rumor sites, I feel the same way all the time.
Yep.
So, should we get into this film of ours?
Yeah, the Star Wars Holiday Special.
Yeah.
B. Arthur.
B. Arthur Takes Manhattan.
I'd watch that movie. So, our usual structure is we do initial short impressions of the film in general, and then we kind of go through the plot as kind of expediently as possible, but stopping along the way to talk about moments and things we liked, didn't like, and then kind of end with a overall conclusion of how we felt about the film. And, so I'm the new Muppet guy here. I have not seen most of these films, and Steve's hated me for my whole life. We've known each other for 20 years, something like that, Steve.
And somehow I never forced him to watch all these.
Yeah, and I've watched
all that time.
Why do you like the Muppets? That's silly. And now I'm actually finally going through them and watching them, and I'm appreciating them, so it's good.
That's great.
Yeah, better late than never.
So my thought was that this was going to be the one that Jarman did not like of the original three.
Just of the original three.
Because he really enjoyed the other two, but I predicted this is going to be the one that he didn't like as much. So tell me, was I right, Jarman?
Yes, you would be correct. So,
okay,
the first, we kind of are equating these things to the Star Trek movies too. But basically, the first one had some problems, but had a lot of promise. Some slow parts, some kind of odd parts, but then the second one I felt was really solid. In my opinion, I liked it a lot. It moved very quickly.
You said you liked the music better in.
Yeah, I liked the music better in the second one because they were kind of shorter, faster songs, and it wasn't kind of, it didn't drag at all. And the jokes were really on point. I love John Cleese. He was hilarious. And then this one I felt like slowed down a lot more again, but also I almost feel, as I'm a film major, I don't know if that has anything to do with biasing my view, but it felt like it was cut very strangely. Like a lot of the jokes just kind of fell flat to me. Like one of the examples of is like the Joan Rivers scene. It just felt like if that was cut a little snappier, it would have been funnier. It kind of just like, ugh. I don't know, it just fell flat.
You just stabbed me in the heart, yes, a little bit. I'm done with this interview.
I know.
That's
I love
such
it.
A great scene. How could you think
that? And we just caused our first guest to rage quit.
Yeah. Congratulations, Charm. That's what we want, drama for the show. But no, so that's my overall opinion is that, but though overall, I did enjoy it. It was sweet. And my also overall feeling was that it felt a lot more just based towards a kid audience as compared to the last two films, which had a lot more mix of adult humor and kid humor. This one I felt had a lot less adult humor and more just more kid friendly, which isn't a bad thing. It's just that it just wasn't as engaging to me as the first two. But that's my general first impression. And now the Muppet fans can take it away.
Now get them, guys.
Yeah, no, it's funny that your reaction was that it was more kid friendly, because I think the way I've always thought of it, it's the one that was directed by Frank Oz, yeah, and co-written by Frank Oz. He has always been interested in adding depth and believability to the characters. So I've always thought of it as kind of like the most adult of the three.
Yeah, I agree with that. There's fewer, you know, sex jokes than the first two, right, for sure. But you know, the thing that I think both of you guys just touched on is this, you know, you say believability and like the realism of Muppet, yeah, Sigma Hand, which like this is definitely the one of any of the Muppet movies that could take place in the real world.
It feels like it takes place, right, in the real world. Like I think that was, right, a deliberate.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And not just like they're on the streets of New York, but like, you know, the physics makes sense in this movie. And like the humor is feel very like it's about things that they say and not like, you know, like, you know, Gonzo's nose got stuck to a thing and he's flying through the air.
It's a little bit less wacky.
Yeah,
cartoony.
Which is something that I really appreciate. Like, you know, it really boils the Muppets back down to they just want to put on a show. Like, right, that's kind, mm-hmm, of what, you know, they've always been a, like, that's what they've always wanted to do, like, at their core.
Right. I think this movie would stand alone if, you know, of course there are some slapstick moments. I think of them going after Martin Price and Animal in the Door and some stuff that could only be done by the Muppets. But you could take this story and throw a bunch of kid actors into it, like college grade actors, and it would still be a complete story that made sense front to back.
Yeah.
Kids moving to the big city, getting scammed. They leave to find jobs.
Right, exactly. Yeah. That, yeah, kind of story has been done.
Yeah. And that might be the biggest flaw of the movie, in my opinion, is, you know, if you can do it without Muppets, why are the Muppets in it?
Rare. I absolutely get that.
You know, the other movies, you can't say that. Like, you really need to justify the, you know, the trouble and the cost of, you know, like, it's expensive and difficult to make a movie with puppets. So why did they make this story with puppets? Right. I mean, obviously, it's, you know, it's written by Frank Oz. It's not, yeah, a real question.
I think it's still funny enough and true enough to the characters to justify it. It's interesting. I think the characters never just randomly break into song in this one, do they?
Let me think.
They do the sort of traditional musical thing of they sing what they're feeling like in a musical. But this one, I think all the songs are either performances or like you can't take note for an
cutaway
answer.
Yeah, that's the first thing I thought.
On the soundtrack, but it's not really being sung.
Yeah,
so I think that was another sort of attempt to.
The only thing I can think of is the Rat musical number that might break that mold a little bit.
Yeah. That's true.
And Kermit at the end does start breaking out into song, but they're asking him if he remembers the song, so it kind of fits in, I guess.
Yeah, true. It's him. Furthers the plot. Performance.
And something, right, you touched on, they said this is the one that feels like it can be in the real world. Something I wrote in my notes is that compared to the last two films, which is all I have to compare it to, it seems like this is the most that humans have acknowledged them as actual animals that they are. like they're constantly referencing the chickens and the dogs and the bears and, you know.
Yeah.
And so I think that was
there are definitely jokes in the previous one. Like the first thing that came to mind was Cloris Leachman in the Muppet movie, you know, allergic to all the animal fur.
Oh, yeah.
And the whole conflict of the Muppet movie is based around Kermit being a frog and Doc Hopper wanting him to do frog legs.
Doc Hopper.
Yeah. That was pretty good.
I'm Doc Hopper.
We played that clip. That was great. Played that clip so many times in that episode.
I'm Doc Hopper.
Anytime we mentioned Doc Hopper,
I just stuck that in there.
I'm Doc Hopper.
So, German, let's start walking through the movie from the beginning to the end. Oh, I'm going to make you do it and put you on the spot.
So I did notice a much more low-key and plain opening credit sequence showing the skyline, which I think you touched on that being set in the real world, directed by Frank Oz. I mean, it's kind of difference. They wanted to set the tone that this is not the meta kind of opening from the last movie where they're falling from the sky and talking about the movie, basically.
Yeah, I think it's also there are no references to them being aware that they're in a movie in this one.
That's true.
The first one had a few, and the second one was the whole thing was about them knowing.
That's true.
Movie,
and
this one,
the next few, are they aware they're in a movie in Muppets from Space? I don't recall.
I don't know that they ever.
Yeah, but the rest of them, they definitely do.
Yeah.
And then it was kind of a cute little song from Kermit there. He's kind of scatting, I guess. It's interesting. And then
I love that.
We have Together Again, which is a song that Steve has sung most of my life that I've known him, and I never knew what it was from, and now I heard it and had some
German memory. Is getting references that I've been using for 20 years. And just since we started this series, he's starting to understand my references.
It's lovely. And you guys have stopped me anytime we get through here.
We will. Don't worry.
So from there, I remember picking up a little bit as they go into the musical number at it was not the talent show, but I guess the senior show at the end, the variety show they put on. And it was just cool looking out that scattering of 80s mustaches and hairstyles that were out in the audience.
Which if you had paused, you would have seen Steve Whitmire in the audience. And is Marty Robinson in there or David Rudman or something like that? No, David Rudman wasn't with that.
I don't know.
Definitely Steve Whitmire though. You'll see it amongst the crowd in
his
very large curly blonde hair.
Yeah,
and the puppeteers 80s, like they cameo all over this movie, don't they?
There's a few more. Jim and Frank are both in the movie. Who else is in?
I thought I saw Jim Henson as the carriage driver later.
Yeah, Jim Henson's carriage driver. Frank Oz is in there later on. They're giving a presentation with the ad company, and Frank Oz is sitting around the table.
Yeah, he's there like 1.5 seconds.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So it picks up pretty quickly. The speech was really nice. He gives the crowd. Oh, and there's kind of the rapey animal chasing the woman around and the audience laughing at it. But that's an undated reference.
That's a joke that doesn't really date so well. Chasing women. Yeah.
They don't really do that anymore.
Yeah, over the years, they have really ramped back the animal chauvinism.
Woman!
Like really stuff. Just they're turned that dial way down to zero.
Yeah,
he eats glass, man.
He eats glass.
Sorry, there's a Frank Oz quote where he talks about animal. And he's what is it? Animal's all about drums, sex, and food or something?
Drums, sex, food, something, and pain. I feel like there were five.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah, maybe. And then Frank Oz says, you don't want to mess with animal. He eats glass, man.
That's appropriate.
Yes.
Then they decide they're going to take their show on Broadway. And I think the main inspiration for Kermit and Miss Piggy is so they can afford to get married, which is very sweet.
Which, by the way, that is a totally natural thing to just be like, you know what? We're just going to put our show up on Broadway and then we'll make $1 million and then we're going to get married.
Of course.
Like, that's what we all did, right?
It's also,
that's right.
It's interesting that they start the movie with Kermit and Piggy already essentially being engaged, and like Kermit is totally okay with that. That's not always the way that.
Yeah, I did notice that. He's chasing him around until he finally, you know, succeeds to her.
She beats him into submission,
or really until they, you know, fall back into the status quo of, are they together? Are they not together? I don't know. Right. You have to watch the next thing and find out.
By the way, I just did some sneaky googling. It's animals' personality is sex, sleep, food, drums, and pain.
Oh, sleep
was the other one.
What a weird life.
Yes, and yet totally relatable.
Yes, of course. So they go around New York looking for a producer to put on their play, not with much success. Well, at first, they run into their first one, I think, was Martin Price's office, where we see Beverly Crusher, Star Trek connection.
Yeah. Isn't that a great cameo? Who, Gates McFadden, who also did some choreography work for Jim Henson.
For Labyrinth.
Yeah.
And she was assistant choreographer on Dark Crystal also.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
That was her first thing. And in fact, one of my few pieces of like signed memorabilia is I went to New York Comic Con and took my Dark Crystal poster with me.
Nice.
And so she's just signing, you know, Star Trek stuff. And I come up and unwrap it. And she just stared at it for a moment. Because how many people come to her to get her to sign, like, Muppet stuff?
Yeah. That's awesome.
She was very happy. Right?
So yeah, I've got Gates McFadden's signature on a Labyrinth poster.
That's awesome.
Great.
I do want to back up about the Martin Price scene.
Yeah. Yeah.
So one thing that I always find interesting about Muppet Take Manhattan is it's the only Muppet movie that does not have a villain.
Yeah.
And Martin Price is
like a central antagonist. Yeah.
Exactly. Martin Price comes closest. And by which I mean he's a villainous character. He is definitely not, you know, the overall antagonist.
No, the villain is failure.
Yes, exactly. Which is actually kind of, I mean, that's really, it's progressive. It makes for unique storytelling. And I don't know, I'd actually be surprised if we ever see, this kind of story again from the Muppets because, it's kind of, I hate to say it's dumbed down now, but it's a little bit dumbed down now.
That's kind of what they were doing on the TV show, the ABC series. And but then they brought in some sort of slightly like antagonistic characters, I guess, because they felt like that was missing.
And it's easy. It's easy conflict to have someone who just says they want the opposite and let's fight them.
Right.
But Martin Price is definitely the only one who really they have to rally against.
Well, kind of what you've been telling me about this movie kind of helps me look at it in a different light and the sentimental aspect and the kind of the characters and having them more well-rounded, because my only experience with Sesame Street or the Muppets growing up was Follow That Bird, which is what I had.
Oh, great movie.
I had it on VHS cassette that I recorded off the television and I played it over and over again. I cried every time I watched it. So I think that is something I just didn't expect anymore from Muppets was to have this sentimentality and the touching moments and just being sweet. And the first two movies I watched weren't really sweet and touching and sentimental. They were goofy, slapstick kind of comedy. So if this is what I'm more going to expect, that's kind of cool.
Yeah, there's some sweet stuff in those movies, but you're right. But in my opinion, the Muppets, the sentimentality of the Muppets, the heart of the Muppets that a lot of people talk about works best when it's few and far between. Mm. We've been seeing like silly stuff, funny stuff, like this wacky, weird puppet things and, these crazy characters. And then suddenly, Gonzo sings a sad song and you're like, oh my God, my heart.
Yeah.
That's like that. It's almost like that whiplash that really makes it work so well.
Yeah, I would say the Muppet movie had more of that than Great Muppet Caper, probably.
I'm going to go back there someday. I mean, it's
right.
It makes me tear up every time I hear it. My wife and I danced to it at our wedding.
That's sweet.
Yeah,
it's a
sad song to dance to at your wedding.
It is. I know, but it's sweet and about ending up with who you should be with in a universal sense, and I like that.
Okay,
we're breaking hearts here. Next term.
They go eventually, I'm not sure how they got to there, but I think they just go to find their last bit of food because they have no money left, so they go into, is it Pete's Diner?
Pete's Luncheonette, and
he gives that speech to Kermit the Frog all about people is people is people, people is people. Yeah. Like that.
People is people.
I did enjoy that.
It's fun. It's people.
Hey, I tell you what is. Big city. Live, work, but not city open. Only peoples. Peoples is peoples. No, it's buildings. It's tomatoes, huh? It's peoples. It's dancing. It's music. It's potatoes. So, peoples is peoples. Okay?
Yeah. Thanks. That helped a lot.
Which, by the way, Pete's Luncheonette, the exterior that they used was the same as the Seinfeld diner from the pilot of Seinfeld.
Yeah. It looks somewhat familiar, yeah.
And now it's a McDonald's.
I know. It's so sad. And like when I moved to New York, I remember looking up on Google Maps or something like that and seeing it there, be like, I have to go and I have to go see Pete's.
Oh, you saw?
I saw it before it was
still the diner on Google Maps?
Yeah. Oh, so like within that time, within like the next few months was when it was knocked down and turned into McDonald's, which is
terrible.
Oh my God, it's terrible. It should be a national landmark, damn it.
That's right. Every Muppet location.
There should be shrines there.
That's right.
Yeah. Kermit ate here.
Oh. And I always love Kermit's moments in all three of these movies so far where he suddenly just gets really deadpan and sarcastic. I think he did it with not Kojak. You just told me his name earlier, Steve.
Oh, Peter Falk?
Peter Falk in the last movie where he just gets really deadpan. Like, and this one he did again. He's like, thanks. That helped a lot. I love this.
Columbo,
exactly.
Kojak was in the first movie.
Oh, that's right. Kojak was in the first
movie. Telly Savalas.
The Night Stalker.
Yeah.
Why do we know all these outdated terms? It's ridiculous.
I don't know. We're all old people.
That's true.
Which movie was Ironside in?
Was he in one of them?
No, I don't think so.
I forgot his name now, though. But yeah, he's in
Raymond Burr.
Oh, right. Raymond Burr was Ironside.
So yeah, they end up at Pete's.
Right. And this is where I wrote down in my notes that I was like, the dialogue doesn't seem as snappy as the last one. And now that I'm talking to you guys, I'm glad we review these things. It makes me look in a different light, and it doesn't have to be as snappy, but I was just so used to that.
Yeah, I think that was intentional.
Right. I think I was so used to that, and I expected it again, so I went into it blind and said, like, whoa, this is, you know, just really not as, you know, fast-paced and quippy as the last movie. It didn't feel like a 1940s movie anymore.
They're still good jokes, but they're just not as funny.
It's a little more dry. Yeah. And I think it's also important just to remember, like, how versatile the Muppets can be. You know, they can do, you know, something, you know, a madcap episode of the Muppet Show. They can do a little bit more of a low-key movie. They could do kid stuff. They could do adult stuff. They could do adult, like, really adult stuff. You know, I think a lot of people, and that may have been, you know, this is getting a little bit off topic, but may have been one of the big problems with the recent Muppet TV show that failed, because people had certain expectations for what the Muppets should be without realizing, no, the Muppets are many things.
Yeah, you got to give them a chance to do different things.
That's right.
That could be the problem, that each person has their own personal experience with Muppets because it's so ubiquitous.
Exactly. Yeah, everybody remembers what they remember from when they watched it at, you know, when they were 5 years old, and everyone's idea is different.
Everyone's wrong except for me is what it is.
Yep, that's accurate.
Well,
what I remember in my head is what it should be.
Well, they can't realize that Muppets can be everything, and it's instead of just one thing that you remember it as. That's difficult. So
exactly.
I can see that. Same thing with Star Trek, really. It's like you've seen one movie, it's like they're all very different compared to that one movie.
Oh, man, totally.
They should be.
Totally. Like, I got my wife into Star Trek The Next Generation a couple years ago. And then she said, let's watch all the movies. And I went, well, we can watch most of the movies. I don't think you need to watch Star Trek 1 or 5. Like, we can skip
those. Bad. Yeah, we're going
That's
through
the
all those, too.
That's the equivalent of skipping Muppets from Space.
Yeah, she doesn't need to watch that either.
Or Muppets Wizard of Oz.
No.
See, I'm told you Jarman is insisting on watching this thing for this review series, and I'm keeping
it. Oh, no, and you absolutely should.
I'm going to.
No, watch everything once.
You
watch everything one time.
You got to watch
some of them. You never have to watch again.
I will also say, and I'm sure you guys know this because you've been reviewing a lot of different things, but like at least in my experience, reviewing the bad stuff makes for the best reviews.
Oh, yeah.
Like,
yeah, they're always the most fun.
Bad reviews. Yeah.
Because you go through so fast if you really loved it. Let's see.
So the gang breaks up.
Right.
You get to see Muppets say a lot of rapid fire succession sad things, which is kind of rare.
That's true.
Yeah.
Like 5 sad lines in a row. That's kind of strange.
are you referring to the song, saying goodbye, the song?
Well, no, and the dialogue leading up to that.
Leading
We'd
up to
the
song.
We'd have to say goodbye to each other. Like, you know, that whole thing.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
At the table. And them lying to Kermit to protect his feelings. It's just so dark for the Muppets.
It really is. And it doesn't help that the logic doesn't make a ton of sense.
Not at all.
Well, what's wrong?
It's just, we've had some job offers, right?
Job offers. Oh, well, that's great.
Well, these job offers are, they're kind of out of town. Right?
Out of town job offers where they are. Yeah.
What job did I get?
Gonzo?
Piggy, are you going too?
Well, come here.
We go bye-bye?
Kermit, we'll all write to you and let you know where we are.
Yeah, and Kermit, we still believe in the show.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We got to leave him there by
himself.
We still
believe in the show, but I'm actually moving to San Francisco.
And we're all moving to different places to make it harder for us to all get back together and do the show.
That is quite a little plot hole there. But I did love what it led to, which was Kermit on the building was that?
That's the Empire State Building. Yeah, yeah, the frog is staying.
The frog is staying. I love that.
You hear me, New York?
Yeah, that's great. That reminds me, we did an email interview a few years ago with a writer who was brought in to kind of punch up the script. And I forget, I think that was David Meach. Does that sound right?
Yes.
but I forget if this was one of his ideas that was rejected or just one of the things he remembered from the script. But there was a draft where Kermit is going to the Empire State Building and he goes to the elevator and he passes this giant pair of hairy legs, like it was King Kong about to take the elevator up to the top of the Empire State Building.
That would be great.
But for whatever reason, they cut that.
Which is actually, and now that we're talking about all the realism of this movie, like that kind of makes sense.
I think it would have really undercut the emotional aspect of that scene.
That's true. Right. Would have been distracting. But then it immediately goes to Miss Piggy being all incognito, which I thought was a great breaking from that moment. It was really fun. But
yeah, I love it. And especially now that we live in New York, and you know, all the it's New York, like the crazy stuff, like, yeah, we had a pig in a trench coat. Like it's a lot of racket from across the street. It's a bunch of rats running out of a fancy restaurant. It's like, oh, that actually is accurate. That's
it's 100% accurate.
For New York.
Both of us on more than one occasion has reacted to something by going, yeah, it's New York.
That's right.
That's terrifying.
I think I did it yesterday, actually.
Oh, there you go. But saying goodbye, the song. Is probably one of the saddest things I've ever seen in a movie.
I think it's one of the saddest things I've ever seen in my entire life.
A lot of that comes...
That's the Muppet thing that makes me cry.
Yeah, a lot of it comes from just that we love the characters so much. Yeah. But man, like the shot where Fozzie and Ralph are hugging and they're patting each other on the back. And man, that gets me every time.
Yeah.
Saying goodbye. Why is it sad? Makes us remember the good times we've had. Much more to say, foolish to try. It's time for saying goodbye.
Man, and like Gonzo just like hitching a ride in the back of that truck.
Yeah.
And like drive, like the truck drives off into the distance.
Yep.
Some sad stuff.
At least we get to see Scooter riding a bicycle, though.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true.
That looked really cool.
Yeah.
That's nice. Because it wasn't actually a little person. It was just some kind of mechanic.
That's right.
Yeah.
Well, because they were like, well, we've had puppets on bicycles the last two movies. We should do this one, too.
We still have the bicycles.
just show people we can still do it.
A weird thing that happens in all three movies that I think not a lot of people recognize is Scooter sells popcorn in all three movies, which is the most random thing. He sells it in the theater while they're watching the Muppet movie.
Yeah.
And then again, at the Mallory Gallery finale of the Mallory Gallery in Great Muppet Caper. Yeah. And then he is, well, I guess he's not technically selling popcorn, but he's working at the theater, the movie theater in Muppet's Take Manhattan.
Yeah.
Swedish Chef.
Yeah. You have to wonder if they, was it just a coincidence the first two times and then they realized it, so they did it again? Or I don't know.
That is weird.
It's true.
I had in that scene actually when he was selling popcorn with the Swedish Chef. Has it always been the case that they have real people hands on Swedish Chef?
Yeah.
Yes.
They never put like gloves or like anything on there ever, because I don't ever remember seeing real person hands. Yeah.
No, and it throws us off when Andy Samberg on Saturday Night Live used to play the Swedish Chef, he would wear gloves. Right. We're like, Andy, come on, no. Gloves. Yeah.
Because it looks so creepy to me, realizing that. So I'm like, oh, that looks so off with that face and then real hands. Like, it's just terrifying.
Yeah. Well, I mean, the real reason is because he's working with real food, and so that's a easy way to keep the puppet clean.
Right.
But Steve, a little trivia. Do you know who performed the hands of the Swedish Chef?
Ooh.
Oh, lordy, no. I know one was male, one was female.
No, that's not true. No.
Oh. Is that just old wives' tale?
I don't know that tale at all. I think you just made that up.
Oh. That's been one of those little things I've caught in articles over and over again over the years, is that one of the hands of the Swedish Chef was routinely played by a woman.
No, that is incorrect. You know, the Swedish Chef is performed by Jim Henson.
Yep.
And the hands, at least on the Muppet Show,
most of the time,
as often as possible, were played by Frank Oz.
Okay.
And he performed both hands. And, you know, on the Muppet Show, what he used to do was he would kind of do whatever he wanted to do just to get Jim to react. So, which is why the Swedish Chef would throw something across the room. Because he was trying to throw Jim off and have Jim, you know, the Swedish Chef's head react to whatever was happening around him.
Well, and who plays Scooter then?
Well, Scooter's Richard Hunt.
Okay, so different guy entirely. Yeah. So they didn't need one of them to be.
Totally.
Okay. I'm glad I could be here to be the ignoramus here. Doesn't know anything.
Well, that's often, right, well, and that's often how, why you see sort of the same Muppet pairs.
Right.
Sometimes is because it was easier for them to have a character that Jim played and a character that Frank played.
That makes sense.
Versus two characters that Jim played being in the same scene and having dialogue.
It's true. That was rare. See that very often. Yeah. Like, you're not going to see Dr. Teeth and Ralph talking to each other very much.
Exactly. Well, it's also why in the Muppet movie, you know, Kermit and Ralph sing a song. And so most people at home, or, you know, at the time, were probably, you know, saying like, oh, how nice is these two characters I love and they're singing a song. But the diehard fans are going, wait a minute, how'd they do that?
Yeah, because one of those puppets had to be a different puppeteer. That's right. Lip syncing or loop plater.
And it was Jim harmonizing with himself.
Yeah, I mean, that's
kind of amazing. But yeah, but Jim and Frank worked very, very well together. They were very much in sync. And, you know, they made a great duo. Likewise, Richard Hunt and Jerry Nelson were, very close.
Yeah.
So they have a lot of character pairs. And Dave Goles and Steve Whitmire also were very close and had a lot of character
pairs. Yeah, there are a few sort of teams that kind of ended up working together a lot.
I just listened to a podcast recently on Nerdist, and I can't remember who the guest was talking about it, but they worked with Frank Oz as a director, and somebody on set or something asked him to do one of the voices. And apparently that's a huge no-no. And he's just like, those are my characters, my babies. I'm not what is it? I'm a ventriloquist dummy for your pleasure.
He's not a sideshow.
Yeah. You know, it's funny. I've heard him say it's not a party trick.
Right.
Yeah. It's funny. Some of the performers are much more willing to do that. Or then you have like the other extreme is Carol Spinney from Sesame Street, who plays Big Bird and Oscar.
He breaks it out all the time.
Yeah, he'll talk like Big Bird anytime without even being asked.
Yes.
But Frank Oz is, you're better off just never asking him because he does not want to do that for you.
Well, and also Frank understands, you know, it's so much more about a character and a full performance. And, you know, a team effort with the people you're working with and the script and the, you know, whatever it is. And it's not just a voice.
Right.
Like, it's insulting to think it's just a voice.
He's not just a voice actor. It's a puppeteer creating a whole character.
Yeah. That always, I don't know about Joe, but that always bugs me when I see reviews and things that are like, Muppets Most Wanted starring the voices of Steve Whitmire. And, you know, it's like, well,
they're the voices,
but they're also the guys who are like crouching under tables with their limbs contorted into uncomfortable positions for hours on end.
They should be in a similar Oscar category, a new category with those motion capture people. They should all have their own category.
Oh, yeah.
It's kind of similar craft.
How Andy Serkis has not won an Oscar at this point blows my mind.
Yeah.
Just destroys my mind.
He's a human puppet.
Yeah, people don't think of that as acting, I guess.
Anyway, so we go from the all the people finding their different job, which is also very sad whenever we get those letters and they're saying, oh, we're so happy, but really their life is miserable wherever they are, which is very cute. The scene in the cave with the bears and the weird, creepy female bear that wants to snuggle, which I thought was cute.
Yeah.
One of my favorite scenes near that point is where Miss Piggy is noticing the relationship blossoming between Kermit and I can't remember her name.
Jenny,
sorry. I just watched the movie.
Yeah, Pete's daughter, Jenny.
But I love when they start jogging to feel better about things. And she goes, oh, dear Lord, jogging, which I thought was amazing. And her wheezing and everything. So that was a good moment. Who loves fat jokes?
That's a great scene. So this is a funny little aside. So a while back, I met a guy who had a website where he found filming locations from famous movies all over the city. I wrote to him because we've always wondered the scene where Miss Piggy catches up with the purse snatcher and she's sitting in Central Park in front of the big rock. You know, whenever I'm in Central Park, I'm like, oh, was it here? Is that the rock? Like, I don't have a picture in front
there
of me.
There are a lot of rocks.
There are a lot of rocks. Park. So I asked this guy if he could help us find it. And he's like, I'll keep an eye out. Like, I think he genuinely looked for a bit. And then he's eventually like, you know what? I can't.
So can you describe it for me? Yes. It's a big rock. It's surrounded by trees.
Yep. There's still some of the garbage around the base might include a hacksaw, and some lingerie, and one shoe.
And Kermit will be there.
Right. Yes. Yes.
So you never found it.
Never found it. Still looking. It's a big park.
Well, apparently, that's true. One of those women that helps her pick up her stuff is one of the performers from Dark Crystal.
I don't think that's true. I think that was a misconception that got spread around the internet.
Oh, yeah, because it sounded like the trivia page for IMDb.
Yeah, that one's not. I don't think that's accurate. Because if you look very quickly.
Yeah.
One of them looks a little bit like Kathy Mullen, right. who she worked on Dark Crystal.
But I think she confirmed
Fraggle
that
Rock.
Wasn't her.
It was definitely not. Well, now we know what she looks like. Yeah. It's definitely not her.
Oh, gotcha.
Which is a shame because actually would have been a perfect opportunity for a cameo for
sure.
some of the Puppeteers. But yeah, no, I think they were just extras.
That makes sense.
Yeah, some Muppet fans love to try to look for patterns in places where there are no patterns.
Conspiracy Muppet theorists. Yeah.
Like, that guy has a beard. Maybe it's Jim Henson.
So I think that what we're missing in all this is one of my favorite driving forces of the remainder of the film, which is Kermit's ploys and cheap tricks to try to get the show picked up.
I love it. Let me just say.
It's just spectacular.
It feels like when you put it on paper, it feels a little bit out of character for Kermit because – you know, he is manipulating. He's lying. You know, he was doing whatever he can.
Oh, yeah. He's being sneaky.
Which is stuff that Kermit really doesn't do. And, you know, we found out, you know, in the 2011 Muppet movie, there was supposed to be a storyline that was nixed about, you know, the bad guy is really Kermit in disguise. And he's, you know, trying to get it. He really is just a ploy to get his friends back together. And a lot of people rubbed him the wrong way.
Yeah,
they say Kermit doesn't lie. Well, I completely disagree because that's exactly what he does in the Muppet movie.
Oh, yeah.
Sure.
He lies. He risks, like, ruining the reputation of a restaurant. He does all sorts of terrible things.
Exactly. But the thing is like, that's like Kermit. It's way too easy to have him become a passive character and for him to be sad until things get better. Because that is what happens.
That has happened too often in recent years.
Correct.
And that would become boring after a while.
Right. Yeah. So this was like, I thought it was just a perfect way to get Kermit to be active and for him to fight for something and to be funny. Like the scene where he's got the afro and he runs into Leonard Weinstock's agency.
Boffo Lenny, Socko Lenny.
Oh, so man.
That's when he pretends to be, he's pretending to be a producer?
Yeah.
Or an agent?
Yeah, I think he's a producer.
Something like that.
And he runs in with the script and makes a fool of himself.
Yes.
Yeah.
Mr. Weinstock?
Yeah.
A frog with an afro.
Hiya, Lenny, sweetheart, babe. I just flew in from the coast. Hey, I love your office. Don't change a thing. Say, listen, Lenny, my private plane's double parked outside, so I gotta run, but I got this Boffo Socko script for a Broadway slot called Manhattan Melodies. It's totally today, yet tremendously timeless, and I am giving you first look-see because we're like family. Have I ever lied to you, Lenny? Whoop, I think I hear my beeper. Listen, I got a split. I'll have your people call my people, okay? We'll take a meeting, all right? We'll set a conference call. And remember, Lenny, Boffo Lenny, Socko Lenny, okay? I'll call you. We'll have lunch. Ciao.
That costume alone is worth it.
A great scene. It's funny. It's a side of Kermit you don't get to see very often. Like, he's actually got all this energy, which, like, again, like, later Kermit has much less of. And, yeah, I think it was wise for them to go in that direction.
Yeah.
Especially since this really is Kermit's movie. It's also an ensemble, but it's really Kermit's movie.
It's great, too, that at the end of that, as soon as he closes the door, he's like, breathing heavy, kind of recovering from that because it took a lot out of him.
Yeah.
That's a good character moment.
And then I love in the restaurant that it opens with basically Muppet Man.
Muppet Man?
Oh, yeah. Kermit with all the rats under his...
He's on top of the rats and they're walking.
Yeah. Yep.
Reservation.
Well, reservation, Secretary Mini. Reservation.
So the Pete's Luncheonette is no longer there, but the good news is Sardi's restaurant in New York City still has the caricature of Kermit up on the wall.
That's right. It's near the bathroom on the second floor.
Near the bathroom,
if you're ever looking for it. We went there. What was it, like a year ago, 2 years ago?
It was a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
It's there.
And also the picture of Liza Minnelli that he takes down is like that's actually the picture of Liza Minnelli that's up at Sardi's. So that's on the wall as well.
Wow.
That's killer.
The same ones they touched.
That's right.
Yeah.
Hey, that's how we think.
Oh, absolutely. Same way as I know how that is.
Yep.
Yeah, so we had the Jim Henson carriage driver. I noticed that off the bat. He was purposely like turning his head away from the camera, I felt like, but that hair and beard, I mean, it's an escape.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, also the fact that he's wearing jeans, which I feel like.
Oh, I didn't notice that.
It was like, I noticed it every time because it's like, shouldn't he be dressed a little bit nicer? I mean, not that real carriage drivers are dressed that nice, but like, I think, you know, what people think of a carriage driver in Central Park, maybe. I don't know. It doesn't matter.
That's funny.
And one thing I think that we just accidentally chronologically skipped that
I think we've been skipping
to get into
a lot of things.
Was the Joan Rivers scene.
Oh, I skipped it on purpose.
Yeah. Oh, man. Okay, yeah. Yeah, let's
no, I want
to
hear
let's go
this.
Back to Joan Rivers for a second. First of all, I think this needs to stick. It's just, she's funny and Piggy's funny, and it's got this great build.
Yeah, it does. It keeps building, and like, yes, it gets more, and they get increasingly frantic and increasingly, yes, hysterical.
But the best thing, now that I've seen that scene probably 119 times.
legit.
The fact that, like, they had to do that in one take, because they are ruining that Miss Piggy
moment. Unless they had another, yes, one standing by, but Miss Piggy is, as far as we've heard, a character that it's expensive and time consuming to make a Piggy.
Yes. Yeah.
So, yeah.
And it's also, like, Frank Oz is just that good of a performer that he knew that, like, yeah, we can do this thing in one take.
Yeah.
You know, and Joan Rivers is just such a pro.
It definitely sounds spontaneous, because you have lines like, Joan Rivers says, "You need doe eyes." And she says, "What are doe eyes?" And Joan Rivers says, "Doe eyes are Bambi eyes."
Just very random.
Yeah, what it does is that mean?
Well, I think that what Jarman might be feeling might be exactly what you guys are describing, is the difficulty of doing it in one shot, is that I feel that that scene feels detached, because you have one basic one set shot of Joan, yeah, Rivers and Piggy. Camera doesn't really move a whole lot. You don't get a lot of other angles on it.
Yeah, that was kind of feeling.
And you just get these cutaway reaction shots from people that are a little bit far away. I can see what German's saying about it not being as integrated. And that could be a result of them only getting one chance to do it. So they had to do it a certain way.
That makes a lot more sense when I think about it. Because, like, yeah, there was a two shot the whole time. They never cut away until the end, when they're basically, you know, completely covered. And then they cut away and show people staring at them. And so that makes sense why it felt just out of place for me. Because that whole other movie is shot normally back and forth between characters, and this is just a two shot, like you're watching a play or a live TV show or something.
Hmm. Yeah, that's a good point. And you know, I'm also realizing as we're talking about this that it was among the crazier things that happened in the movie, just because of the energy that they're going through. But you compare it to some of the crazier elements of any other Muppet production.
That's true.
And just again, on paper, like, it just pales in comparison, because all they're doing is putting on makeup and laughing.
It stands out in this movie.
Yes. But again, it's because it's so real. And I wonder if that's also because of this movie, more so than any other Muppet movies, is such a product of its time. And, like, this is just kind of what, you know, 80s rom-com-ish movies were like. It's very like When Harry Met Sally, you know, like that same kind of humor. And I don't know. I don't actually have a theory about this. It's just kind of hitting me right now. So I'd have to put more thought into it. But, like, you know, that isn't that far-fetched. It's not that far out of the question.
It's weird because you say that rom-com thing, because that scene with Kermit yelling, you know, "I'm staying," it just, for some reason, immediately hit me. That could be like Tom Hanks or Billy Crystal sitting there saying that in that shot, the way it was done. It felt like one of those movies from like the 80s, early 90s kind of thing.
Yeah.
Kermit has been compared to Tom Hanks before.
I just watched Splash for the first time recently.
First time.
Wow. I've never seen one. And that's something I could see Tom Hanks run around the same city around the same time.
Yep. Yeah, it's true.
You know, with this, you know, animal human hybrid.
Of course.
And then one of my favorite scenes from when I was a kid comes shortly after that, which is the Central Park chase scene.
Oh, with Greg Hines. Great.
Keep the skates. I never use them anyway. I just like to run around in shorts.
Gregory Hines is perfect. All he wants to do is run around in shorts.
And Gregory Hines is great. It's a little distracting in the shots where it becomes very obvious that it's a human in a Miss Piggy costume.
Yes. In the roller skating. That's a little creepy, yeah.
Maybe not quite as distracting as that one shot in Great Muppet Caper where she dives off the top of the fountain into the swimming pool.
Yep.
Because it's not, they I don't think they ever go quite as close up on her. But yeah, that's a little weird.
I read an interview, and I wish I could remember any of the details about it right at this moment, but there was an interview out there somewhere with the actress who played Miss Piggy in that scene.
Oh, wow.
Mm-hmm. Who is
doing the roller skate?
Yeah, because she's a little person who is also like a pro skater, which is like that weird Venn diagram.
That's exactly who they needed.
So many of those.
Exactly. But that's a great scene. And then the scene where Gregory Hines is, you know, in the middle of this conversation that he doesn't understand anything about is one of the best, like, that's one of the best cameos.
You gave her the huggies?
You gave Jenny the huggies.
That was my favorite. That was my favorite cameo of the movie. Yeah, by far.
Yeah. I actually, I think it was for an article I wrote for the website. I realized I wanted to embed that scene in the article. And I realized that no one had uploaded it to YouTube yet at the time.
What?
So I posted just, yeah, I posted just that scene on YouTube so I could put it in my article. And it's been funny over the last few years to see comments come trickling in. And it's like people have started debating who was right and who was wrong in that argument between Kermit and Piggy.
And that's the answer is Hitler, of course, because it's the internet.
Yes.
Oh, always. Yeah. It always comes down to that.
So Piggy, Kermit now knows Piggy's in town. Piggy takes a job at Pete's Diner.
Mm-hmm. Well, hang on. You skipped a pretty important scene here.
Oh, yeah. The baby scene.
This is the introduction of
the scene that led to 8 years of Saturday morning cartoons.
Yeah. Muppet Babies debuted like 2 months after this was released, I think. Something like that.
It was something like that.
I feel like it was a little bit further because I don't, and correct me if I'm wrong. I'm just kind of going off of fuzzy memory here, but like, this was kind of a test to see if audiences would like it, and then they decided to make a Saturday morning cartoon. But is that not accurate?
They made the decision to make the cartoon before the movie had come out. Once they actually saw the sequence with the puppets, they decided that it was going to work.
Now, when I was a kid, I was not much of a Muppet Babies fan because, I liked the Muppets, and Muppet Babies was a baby version of that. Like young Joe could not comprehend.
I always hated, like, in third grade or so, when I would say I liked the Muppets and somebody would go, "Oh, Muppet Babies?"
No.
The Muppets.
Jeez, man.
All right, here it is. Muppet Baby. So, Muppets Take Manhattan came out July of 84, and Muppet Babies debuted September.
Wow, okay. Same year.
Yeah, so they definitely had already started on it.
But the thing that I don't think, it took me until like maybe I was a teenager to really appreciate that scene, the Muppet Babies scene in the movie, because it's not just that it's Muppets, puppet versions of the cartoon characters. But like the puppetry in that scene is phenomenal. If you watch it again, the puppets are really small and the puppeteers are completely hidden in these like tiny holes in the carpet, I guess. I honestly don't know where they are in most of the scenes, like, or how these puppets move. You know,
I think my favorite aspect of the scene is that you get to hear their interpretation of baby voices.
Yeah.
Yeah. They're doing baby versions of their own characters. Right.
Yeah. That's fascinating. Also interesting that there's no baby animal in that scene.
That's true.
And he would become like the breakout star. Exactly. Muppet Babies.
Yeah. So you do get to see baby animal in Muppet Family Christmas.
I was just going
to
say this. Yeah. Yeah. Muppet Family Christmas. Right, they had the puppet.
He ruins the, ruins their pageant and then ruins the film.
That's right.
Oh, animal.
So they obviously had the puppet. I don't recall if the puppet shows up in the music video for "I'm Always Gonna Love You." I'm gonna always love you.
I don't think so. But by the way, if you haven't seen that music video, you should definitely.
I've got to check it out now.
You really should. It's phenomenal. It's bizarre, and it's again like product of its time. Like,
absolutely,
they wanted this thing to be on MTV.
Yeah,
Jim Henson shows up as himself with slick back hair, a
very brief cameo.
He's got these like 80s like thin sunglasses,
like wraparound sunglasses.
I've seen a reference to that. They show a quick clip of it in The Muppets Celebrate Jim Henson.
Yes, they do. Yeah, that's what that's from.
Okay, that's the. Yeah. I didn't know what it was from, but I'll check it out now.
Yeah. And I guess like they had the puppets for like photos and stuff because they have some Muppet Babies.
Yeah, there were some
photo
like,
books.
There was a fairy tale book where they were. Yeah. It was puppets. Yeah.
Huh. Just such a weird phenomenon, these Muppet Baby puppets that they use like three times and then never again.
And they were adorable.
They were adorable.
And the whole Muppet Babies thing started the craze of like everybody else then started doing younger versions of their established characters. Like
Flintstone kids.
A pup named Scooby-Doo. Yeah. And Yo-Yogi.
Yeah. We probably wouldn't have Rugrats without that too, I'd imagine.
That's right.
You know, that may be true. Yeah, Rugrats. I always thought Rugrats was kind of a stole the ideas from
proving that funny talking babies were.
Well, it wasn't just talking babies. It was babies, and like all the stories had to do with their imaginations running wild.
Yeah, that's true.
I can see that. Huh.
Okay, so back to the story.
I like it.
What's story? We're
part of the story.
Dream sequences, and
so they get a job. She gets a job at Pete's. Kermit gets a letter from Bernard Crawford, a Hollywood, Broadway producer, and goes to meet him, thinking he's going to pitch the show.
But he finds his son instead.
Dun, dun, dun.
Ronnie Crawford. Who Bernard Crawford, by the way, played by Art Carney, who worked with the Muppets. Do you know the year 1960 something or other?
Oh, in the Great Santa Claus.
Great Santa Claus.
1970.
Yeah, with the Ed Sullivan Show.
And he also appears in the Star Wars Holiday Special.
Oh, no way!
That's who that was.
Yes, he does.
Oh. Wow, way to tie it together.
Oh, he was the worst part of that.
Yeah, I thought I recognized him.
No, he wasn't. No. There was a lot of other worst parts of
that. That's true. I'm exaggerating. Well, they all tie for worst part.
I noted that scene had a very questionably progressive line in it. Where he says, "Dad, I have great news," and he's like, "If you two are in love, I don't want to hear about it." And so,
yeah,
that's
like,
true. Well, I actually thought about that.
That progressive. He
doesn't want to hear about it, but the fact that they actually included that line in there, I was like, "Huh, that's interesting." Half not progressive because of how he's saying it, but also it was like, just including it, is that a good thing? I'm not sure. It's like, I don't know.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I think that he would have been okay with it if they were dating. He would have been like, "Look, I don't understand it. But, like, give me some time and I will be supportive."
It's not because he's a man, it's because he's a frog. That's why.
Right.
Yeah, so wait. Go ahead, Steve. You're doing better at this than I was.
Okay, so so they're going to do it. He runs out excited, misses the crosswalk, gets hit by a cab.
So they're going to produce the show, but he only has, what, like a week to put it all together? 2 weeks.
2 weeks.
I don't think, does he know that at the time, though?
No, he doesn't know.
Not until Ronnie comes in later
and announces it to everyone else.
Yeah, I mean, we assume he doesn't know, because we don't know what the conversation is. Actually, we do know. He runs right out the door. So he doesn't have any details. But yeah, he runs right into traffic. Now, here's the thing. Now, Steve, was it you who said you lived in New York?
Yeah.
Previously? So, you know, there's so much traffic in this city. Like, cars can't really get to high speeds to really, like...
To really nail someone, to hit you hard enough.
Not in the middle of the day like that.
Right.
No,
to,
like, absolutely
hit you
not.
Hard enough to give you, you know, cartoon-y amnesia. So, yeah. I don't know where I'm going with this. I thought that maybe there's some
sort
of
logic. You're absolutely correct.
Yeah.
So he ends up in the hospital.
Yep. With the worst doctor ever, Linda Lavin.
Yeah. Former Muppet Show guest star Linda Lavin.
Right. And she does things like she twists his arm and
that's my one of my favorite parts.
I love when they do puppet comedy like that, like just messing with the puppets for comedic effect.
Well, I just love the joke. Again, did not get this as a kid, but like the joke where she does those weird tests and then she goes, no doubt about it, you got amnesia. Yeah. Like, what? How was that an amnesia test?
I did laugh at that one. That was good.
No doubt about it, you have amnesia. Mm-hmm. Now, the problem is you were found with no identification and, oddly enough, wearing no clothing. So, I did some research into the major nudist colonies in the area and I think I've come up with something.
Hmm?
You are Mr. Enrico Tortellini of Passaic, New Jersey.
Well, I really don't feel Italian.
It was just a long shot.
We were also positing the other day, you know, when she says, you know, I think we know, we figured out who you are. You're Mr. Enrico Tortellini of Passaic, New Jersey. And we thought, you know, whatever happened to Enrico Tortellini?
He might still be wandering the streets of New York with no idea who he is.
And no clothes on.
He's a fraud. Yeah. It's just crazy.
That's right.
He's Italian nudist with nowhere to go.
That's right. Without a home. Poor guy.
You should write that fan fiction at some point.
Yes. The world wants to know.
So Kermit is missing. Pete calls back all of the Muppets with the most nonsensical telegram ever.
Yep. Yep.
Pop, could you send telegrams to Kermit's friends?
Oh, please.
Hockey ducky.
Let's go.
Great. Come on.
He's no sweat. I write good. Dear bears and chickens and things, is New York, is play, is time.
Pete is a big fan favorite, I think, among Muppet fans.
Oh, absolutely. And meanwhile, they're looking for Kermit, leads to a big musical montage of them.
Oh, yeah. So it's one of our favorite musical instrumental moments for me and Ryan. as we walk the streets of New York and we go do 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 do. That's our searching for Kermit music.
It's adorable.
That's how we met Ed Koch. No, it's not true. We didn't meet Ed Koch that way.
Didn't he die like last year or something?
Yeah. The former Ed Koch. That's what horrible. He is. I guess he's still
all
Ed
I know
Koch.
Is Ed Koch.
No, he's not.
He's a whole other crap.
He's not anything
the
right now.
Formerly living Ed Koch.
Yeah.
That's terrible. That was a good cameo, though.
That was a good cameo.
So they're looking for him. Kermit looking for a job now in clothing. Now he doesn't know who he is. Accidentally wanders into what, an ad agency?
Which is also interesting as we were discussing like the realism of this movie. And then just to make it a little bit more real, Kermit gets a job as a boring ad man.
Yeah.
And they're all frogs, which is great. I actually really enjoyed all the interactions with them. And you guys tell me if this is true, but they had this in the trivia section that apparently this is all an allegory of Jim Henson's career, because apparently when he couldn't get success at first, he tried to work at an ad agency.
No, that's bullshit.
You guys need to work
that's
on this IMDb page and like fix it for him.
We get speculation.
Yeah, please,
we'll start by deleting everything. Yeah, right. But I will say
there are two things in there that are probably true.
What's interesting about that scene is the other puppeteers who are playing the other frogs are all doing their Kermit the Frog impression.
Oh, fun! I thought it was all Jim Henson.
One of whom is Steve Whitmire. So you hear Steve Whitmire, I can't remember if he's Gil or Bill, I don't know which one's which, but doing his Kermit impression, which, like, if you close your eyes, that's the Kermit the Frog that we got from 1990 to today.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
True.
I just love the whole Gil, Bill, and Jill. That was just really fun.
Oh, yeah. It's great. That stuff is gold. Yeah.
And Ocean Breeze soap will get you clean.
Yeah, that's brilliant.
Love it.
It's like an ocean cruise, except there's no boat, no water.
You don't have to go anywhere.
Love it.
For people who don't want to stink.
He's got a weird voice he puts on, too, as the I can't say that word.
Yeah, apparently when he forgets who he is, he also forgets how he speaks.
It's like a robot.
Right, which kind of makes sense,
yeah.
I guess.
Sure.
Yeah, sure. So... The four of them are out to lunch, an ad lunch, and they stumble into Pete's diner, and all the Muppets have basically given up on finding Kermit, and Kermit somehow remembers and plays the glasses. Dun, 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 dun. Someone overhears it. They realize it's Kermit. Everyone freaks out. Kermit remembers no one.
Tragic.
Tragic. Sadness. So he's dragged to the theater because the show's got to go on. They're trying to get him to remember. And then finally, what fixes all amnesia, from what I'm understanding from cartoons, takes a hit to the head and remembers.
Yeah, why isn't
everything.
That the first thing they tried?
They really should have.
Like, I feel like I've seen that in Looney Tunes. I've seen that everywhere.
They obviously hadn't seen that episode of Gilligan's Island where Gilligan got hit on the head with a coconut and lost his memory.
That's right.
And then it got hit by another coconut and got it back.
That's how it works.
Yes. Well, what a brilliant show that Gilligan's Island.
Absolutely.
Teaching us things about anatomy and, you know,
how to kill ourselves.
Medical science.
Now, this scene was the first scene. They've only seen the movie, but I actually teared up a little bit when he got his memory back and was slowly singing to them, and they were all so happy he remembered who he was. Like, I teared up a bit at that scene. That was very touching.
Piggy? Fozzie? Where am I anyway?
Kermit!
What's going on?
You're going on. It's Broadway. You made it.
That's right. No, the script isn't ready. There's still something missing.
No, it's terrific.
We gotta tell everybody Kermit's okay. Come on.
Kermit. Do you remember the opening number?
You mean, look at me. Here I am. Right where I belong. I see that face coming back to me like an old familiar song. What better place could anyone be? 'Cause you're here with me. It's all I've been looking for and so much more. And now I'm here, yeah. Now you're here. Nothing can go wrong 'cause I am right where I belong.
Yeah, so I rewatched the movie recently with my wife, and she said that was the one scene that took her out of it a bit because Miss Piggy's style is so dated because she's got the, you know, the permed blonde hair.
It's not a good look for Miss Piggy
and way too
much
eyeshadow. Oh. So like, it looks like she's got these sleepy black eyes. I mean, by black eyes, I mean like she got punched in the eye, not like she's got black pupils. And
not black
it's like, oh, Kermit's like he remembers his friends. And he's singing this sweet song. And there's Gonzo and Fozzie and Rolf and Scooter and oh god, Piggy. Why?
What happened to you?
Yeah, her wig in this is pretty terrible.
That's true, because the rest of their looks are all timeless, whereas hers, she has different hair depending on her mood or the time era.
Yeah,
true.
Yeah, it's the era.
They
really
tried to make it contemporary, but now it just makes it look dated.
Yeah. Just like Star Trek.
That's right.
And then the whole ending, you know, the multiple musical numbers leading into one another, all mounting to what, as a kid, really bummed me out, but now that I'm older, I appreciate it. The wedding scene, when everything kind of slows down.
Yeah.
I remember I'd basically shut the movie off at that point. I was good.
The fourth wall completely is obliterated.
Where is the audience?
Actually, no, it's the opposite.
No, the fourth wall appears.
Yeah. Right.
The audience suddenly ceases to exist, and it's just Muppets in a church watching Kermit Piggy getting married.
Yeah. With all their friends from Sesame Street and the Muppet Show and
even the Fraggle.
Yeah, there's, if you look closely,
Uncle Traveling
Matt, he makes a little appearance there in the front row.
And you got the pig family and the frog family on the respective
love
sides.
It. Yeah, the babies and the grannies.
Oh, yeah.
That's probably crazy to film, I would imagine.
Oh,
yeah.
Sure. A lot of hundreds of puppeteers.
Yeah. Yeah, but like so worth it. Like, how great is that? And again, like, you know, I feel like it harkened back a lot to the Muppet movie, which ended with, you know, hundreds of puppeteers.
Big, right.
Like, oh, really
God, beautiful.
Both of these scenes paying a huge respect to just the history of Jim Henson and the Muppets. And everyone's there, you know?
Look at all these characters. Look at all these puppets we have.
Yeah. Yeah. And they're here, but they're here to celebrate. Like, in the Muppet movie, they were there to celebrate the art of this movie that they created and the connection, the rainbow connection of all these people and characters coming together to create something wonderful. But this was like, they're all here specifically for Kermit and Piggy.
Yeah.
Which is, you know, kind of a beautiful,
it was kind of paying off what the audience had been, the relationship that the audience had been following since the Muppet Show.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
Yeah.
The will they, won't they.
Right.
Was I do.
An unsuspecting scene that he's like not about to say yes because he's like, oh crap, this is actually a real wedding now. And he actually has a moment of hesitation. I appreciated that.
Well, which is like, man, like, so Ryan and I both got married within the past few months.
Congrats.
To different people. And thank you. And, but like,
I was waiting for you to finish that sentence. I was like, to each other? No?
No, to different people. Yeah.
To different people.
We're good. But, you know, the whole idea of, you know, you're up on the altar and you're saying, they're saying, do you? And if you have to think about it, even if the answer is yes, you probably shouldn't be up there.
You shouldn't have been there in the first place.
That's right.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
A little disturbing.
Yeah, not a good way to start off a marriage. Yeah.
And it's purposeful, obviously. They wanted that there to show his hesitation. I wonder why. It's like, I guess.
Well, and talking about the seriousness of the scene and the sort of stark fact that there's only one human and it's the priest.
Uh-huh. That's right. Yeah.
Only one person. And that they point out that the wedding is serious because they could have put a puppet in there and it would have been really silly. Probably you put a real priest in there and then they even mention the line of, I thought Gonzo was going to be the priest.
So you know it's for real.
That's right.
Oh, yeah.
And that guy actually was a real priest that they cast.
Right. So now Jim Henson and Frank Oz are married.
That's right. That's how that works.
If they're in love, I don't want to hear about it.
Or the Jim Henson.
Well, that's the thing with the ending there. I just thought, like, a lot of movies end in a wedding, but they end with like a da 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 da, and it ends. This one was like, da da. And it ended. I was like, what? What? Is it over?
Oh, but no, but then they got to go live up on the moon. Like, how nice is that?
That's where they had their honeymoon.
I really thought it was going to pull out and then show.
That's why they call it that.
I thought like the thing was going to pull out and they showed the audience clapping and the enjoying thing. So I guess that was purposeful and that's great because it's different and I wasn't expecting it, but I just felt kind of like,
it's funny that they just sort of, forget the idea that the audience exists.
Yeah, and it's just done.
Yeah, Jarman, this is a special show just for you.
It is.
There is no audience. You are the audience, bud.
Oh, and you've always been here.
We've all always been the audience. Oh, I'm special.
But no, you can't be in the audience. You have to be in the show along with all the other bears and dogs and frogs and
chickens and things.
That would be great. So you guys, as a whole, out of all the movies that there are, how do you rate this one? I guess also in comparison to the first two.
Let's say the first three.
Right, let's say the first three.
Down a bit, there's a lot.
Of all the theatrical Muppet movies, this is probably my third favorite.
Okay.
I think I would go Great Muppet Caper, Muppet Movie, and then this one. But I love all three of them.
Yeah,
yes, absolutely.
This is, I go back and forth between this one and the Muppet Movie as my favorites. Right now, I'm really feeling like a love affair with Muppet Segment Hen. So, like, wow. I mean, it's just, I think it's just such a wonderful movie. Muppet Movies is more iconic, which is why
it's
that
the
one.
The obvious choice.
It is the obvious choice. But, like, then you watch it and you're like, of course it's the best movie. But the funny thing is that no matter what people say about it, you know, Muppet fans especially, it's never a question of whether you like it, the movie or not. It's where does it fall on your top three of all the Muppet movies. Sometimes Muppet Christmas Carol makes it into the, maybe makes it a top four because that's a great movie as well. But the other ones, they might as well not exist because we're really talking about those originals.
Yeah, absolutely.
You're never tempted to move Muppet Christmas Carol to number three on your list.
I
think it depends on the season.
I love the movie, but it's
a seasonal favorite, so you can enjoy it. It can be in your top three sometimes.
It is, and I mean, you guys will obviously talk about this more when you guys get to Muppet Christmas Carol. But Muppet Christmas Carol it's not a Muppet movie. It's a Michael Caine movie that has Muppets in it,
right?
And I feel like that was something that I had to personally wrap my brain around after the first couple of times I saw it to really enjoy it, because Muppets just make the story better. But it's a completely different animal from the original three.
It's also kind of the movie they had to make in the Jim Henson, the post Jim Henson era.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I think that's the tough part about them, that stint where they didn't do like original stories when they were doing adaptations, Treasure Island, Christmas Carol, that there was already a framework in place and that wasn't necessarily Jim's style. He wanted to be able to go everywhere and do everything. But when you have to
stay within the confines
of a story that already exists, that makes it difficult.
Exactly. We wanted to see the characters do unpredictable things, but they were a little bit.
I don't like saying what Jim would have done is, or what Jim would have thought is. I don't like doing that. But I would guess that if someone said, "Hey, we should do Muppet Christmas Carol," if Jim was still alive, he would have said, okay, well, we're going to do it, but we're going to have it go in a completely different direction. We're going to show how the Muppets screw it up. And that's going to be funny. Take the story that you're familiar with and just completely turn it on its heel. And, the fact that they did one of the best adaptations of the book that, has ever been on film.
One of the truest to the original.
Exactly. Like,
it really is, which is unexpected, but funny.
It goes to show, like, again, how versatile the Muppets can be.
Yeah.
Well, Steve, where does this one fall on your personal list of favorites?
I'm with him. It probably juggles between two or three. I feel like Caper and this are sort of tied for different reasons.
Okay.
As a theater kid, I love the big dreamer move to the big city and make it aspect of Take Manhattan. But the smarmy humor in Great Muppet Caper is just too good to pass up. So I don't know. I feel like they juggle second for me.
All right.
That's fair.
That's reasonable.
Fair. Yeah.
And your first is the Muppet Movie?
Yes.
Good to know. So it's all downhill from here.
It's all downhill. Guys, tell Jarman there are some good things after these three, right?
So
sure there are.
I mean, technically it's downhill.
Oh, boy.
You're but not only helping me. Help but me here, convince him it's going to be okay.
Muppet Christmas Carol is a fantastic movie.
I have
movie.
Seen that it's, one when I was a kid. Yeah, that was good.
Yeah, it's just great. I think you're going to appreciate it even more as an adult.
Right.
Muppet Treasure Island is awful.
Here's where Joe and I differ.
It's terrible.
Note.
Ryan's wrong.
Muppet Treasure Island is fun. It's flawed, but it's a perfectly entertaining. It's not the best Muppet movie, but it's perfectly entertaining.
It's, in fact, the worst Muppet movie.
No, because the one they made after that is
I would Muppets rather watch Space. Muppets from Space any
that
day
is crazy.
Than Muppet Treasure Island.
That is completely
I don't know
crazy.
How to... I can't agree
but
with
here's
that.
The thing. But then... after these two terrible movies, you get a bounce back with the two more recent movies.
All we had to do was wait 12 years. And then we got a good one in The Muppets, and then we got a really good one in Muppets Most Wanted.
And then you just have to ignore Muppet Wizard of Oz entirely. Just push it off to the side with a broom. Just say no.
Oh, well, that's a, that's not a theatrical movie.
Direct to TV movies don't count.
Yeah, if you're talking about that, suddenly you open up the.
That's a whole other.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But Steve, did you actually watch Muppets Most Wanted?
Oh yes.
Okay, good. Because
of course
we have found I've asked this to pretty much everyone that most people I ask, even the diehard fans, did you see the movie? And they go, yeah, I never really got around to it. It's like,
or a lot of them even it. Will be like, oh, I love the Muppets. And you'll say, oh, did you see Muppets Most Wanted, the most recent one? And they would go, oh, what was that? When did that come
There's
out?
There's another one?
Or, yeah. No, my favorite one is the most recent one, Muppets Most Wanted. And they go, is that the one with Jason Segel? I go, ah.
Yeah. Yep. Yep. Are you gonna slip Follow That Bird into your rotation?
We very well could.
Yeah, we have talked about it before on the show, but I think that's one of the few things that you had growing up,
right?
In common,
I've seen
right?
that one. I've seen Muppet Christmas Carol, and Follow That Bird is pretty much like all I had seen. So,
but if you do Follow That Bird, do you have to do Elmo and Grouchland?
Yeah, that's the
I
rule.
Saw it one time when I was working at Blockbuster and got a free rental, but other than that, no.
Is that a feature length movie?
Yeah, it is. It was released theatrically.
Yeah.
Wow.
And it's awful.
That one is not great.
All right, gentlemen, we got to wrap this up. This is getting crazy long, but.
Yes. No problem.
It has been an absolute pleasure having you. You've been two thoroughly enjoyable guests.
Of course.
Thank you.
Invite us back anytime. We love talking about Muppets.
No.
And
obviously.
I know the offer is out there. If you ever need a commentator or a fellow Muppet nerd, let me know.
And maybe we can have you guys back for the final film, Muppets Most Wanted, when we get around to it.
Oh, yeah. That would be great.
Kind of cap things off.
Yeah, that would be fun.
Yeah, we would be happy to do that. So yeah, let us know.
And so thank you guys so much. And before we go with all of our guests, is there anything coming up or any events coming up that you guys want to plug?
We don't have anything specific coming up,
well,
do we?
I don't know about coming up. We're in the middle of an article series right now where it's the 40th anniversary of the first season of The Muppet Show.
Okay.
So we've been reviewing every episode of the first season during the week of its 40th anniversary.
Awesome.
Yeah, so we've been doing that. We only have a couple episodes left in the season.
In the first season, yeah.
In the first season, yeah. But that means you can go back and read all of them.
That's right. So. And if you subscribe to our Facebook or Twitter, or you just bookmark our website, toughpigs.com, then over the next 4 years, we'll be covering all 120 episodes of The Muppet Show.
Yes.
And then who knows what we'll do next. But that's just one of the many things we do. We've got articles and news stories coming out just about every day. And, you know, we've got a lot of things that, you know, now that wedding stuff is pretty much done for both of us, that hopefully this spring and summer, we're going to be launching some new projects, including some video stuff and possibly some fundraising stuff and some more interviews with cool Muppet people. And
good.
You know, we've got a lot of stuff that unfortunately we can't talk about in specifics, because that means we're promising to actually do those things.
Yeah, that's true. No, we do the same thing. We keep everything real vague.
Yes.
We always have more great Muppet geek stuff coming up.
Yes, awesome. Always.
Well, thank you again, gentlemen. It's been an absolute pleasure.
Yes, likewise.
Well, that was a fantastic interview with the guests from toughpigs.com, Joe and Ryan. I cannot believe how extensive their knowledge is, and their love of Muppets is contagious. It made me love the movie more than I thought I did, so I really love that interview.
Toughpigs.com, Facebook, Twitter, you can find them all over the place. They produce a lot of really great content for Muppet fans, so check it out, internet. Here to Play on Nerds, we have developed an interesting rating system to bring to you our ideas on the trailers we're about to review. At the low, low end of the scale, we have Burn It, where we think you should find every copy you can get your hands on and throw it into a barrel fire.
Kill it with fire. And our next step is Drunk Watch, which means that, yeah, I'd watch this movie. It'd be entertaining if I was under the influence of some kind of substance of some kind. But if I was sober, probably not going to check this thing out.
Nope, not going to see it. Next, we've got We'll See, which is maybe we just don't know enough about this movie to tell what the hell it's going to be.
Could be good, could be bad, not sure.
Eh,
And our next category would be Get the Couch Ready, which means I'm definitely going to check this movie out at home. Wouldn't necessarily pay the big bucks of seeing it in theaters, but I'm definitely going to watch it at home. So Get that Couch Ready.
After that, we have Take a Look, where we are recommending for you, our viewers and listeners, to check out this movie and check out the trailer and tell us what you think about it. We wanted to see what you guys think.
It looks pretty good, but we're not quite sure yet.
Yeah, take a look.
Yeah.
Let us know.
And for our final and best category, we have Shut Up and Take My Money.
Shut Up and Take My Money.
This looks so awesome, we're gonna see it.
That's where we cannot wait to give Hollywood bigwigs all of the money that we have earned at work to go see a film for $47. We're so excited, we just have to go see it. We don't have a choice.
And that is our A Play on Nerds official copyrighted trademark system for rating our movie trailers. For trailer reviews, we're cutting it short this week with just one review, but we couldn't pass it up. Alien Covenant. What'd you think of this movie?
I'm so excited. It shows a lot of the old things that we loved. It shows some new crazy stuff we haven't seen before. I think we're seeing a few different versions of the alien that we haven't seen before. There's one that's pale. It might be adolescent. It could be a different version. There's some that have new physical features that you don't quite recognize. I'm very, very excited. Extremely excited.
You've all sacrificed so much to be here and be a part of this thing we're doing.
This crew is made up of couples.
It's the first ever large-scale colonization mission. And everyone back on Earth is really grateful for your hard work and your courage. We're making history here.
This is Weed. What are the odds of finding human vegetation this far from Earth?
Who planted it? You hear that?
What?
Nothing. No birds. No animals. Nothing. What happened here? Where is it?
Let me the fuck out!
Hold on!
Holy shit.
It looks just as pretty as Prometheus trailers did to me, but then Prometheus turned out to be not as great. I enjoy Prometheus, but a lot of people thought it was crap. So I'm worried about but
I don't know. I think that they showed that there's going to be, you know, that there's going to be good action in this, and that's not really how they portrayed Prometheus from my memory.
Yeah, it was all like psychological and
right. I think that they're showing that this is going to be the alien movie that you wanted to see. I think that's what they're doing.
Horror action. Yeah. Straight up. So, yeah.
I'm so excited. But, yeah, it looks like Expedition gets this planet. They find wheat. There's some sort of disease. And then a lot of screaming and a lot of blood.
Very rated R.
Oh, my gosh. I'm so excited for a good rated R alien film.
Absolutely. So I guess it's Shut Up and Take My Money from both of us.
Shut Up and Take My Money as long as the kid doesn't ruin it.
Yeah, as long as you're
able to see. That's always the stipulation. As long as the kid says yes, I will try to see this movie.
Thank you for being a friend. Travel down the road and back again. Your heart is true. You're a pal and a confidant. And if you threw a party.
Well, we do have one thank you. I have to get to really quick here from David Kramich or Captain Hot Dog, who sent us an email.
Aw, David.
He sent us an email. I cannot believe it. So what he said was in reference to our last episode, which we reviewed Star Trek III, The Search for Spock. He said, "What up, nerd players? I was completely embarrassed that I couldn't remember the trumpet player's name in the band Electric Mayhem. Anytime someone has an internet poll about who's your favorite band, I always throw out Dr. Teeth and the Electric Mayhem." Oh, it's okay. Nobody knew that answer except for our experts, apparently, who have action figures of him. He also says, "I'm glad you both gave good reviews for Star Trek III. To be honest, I already knew Jarman enjoyed it. Steve's contributions to the review were completely enjoyable, and I was surprised he didn't mention the Klingon dog, which totally looked like something from Labyrinth or Dark Crystal." That's true.
That's insulting. That did not look like that.
It was pretty rough. And yes, judged by today's standards, the fight scene between Shatner and Lloyd wasn't up to par with maybe the Netflix series Daredevil, but it wasn't until I was an adult that I noticed it, which is, that's fair.
Yeah, that's true.
He says, I'm not an expert in the financial or the fictional race known as the Vulcans, but most of my Star Trek reading is the Vulcan-centric novels, and I could go on and on about Vulcan mysticism and why it appears like magic. I'm going to hold back this time as not to bore Steve. But yeah, because we addressed that it's weird that they're like mysticism, but when they're so intellectual, why do they still think it's magic?
Yeah, why do they still have all of it?
That's a fair point. And he says, my guess on the dialogue that occurs at the end of Empire, this is in reference to our trivia question, what were the last things uttered at the end of The Empire Strikes Back? He says his guess would be Lando saying, don't worry, we'll bring back Han from that bounty hunter. And Leia says, be careful, which is incorrect. And he says, ouch. If that's right, or at least close, I don't want any shout outs. Just nude photos of Jarman or Steve in Leia outfit will suffice.
That's legit. I have that outfit.
He says, live long and prosper, Captain Hot Dog. P.S. Steve and his wife deserve props because good parenting never gets the respect it deserves. The needs of the baby outweigh the needs of the few.
That's legit. Well, thank you so much for that.
The correct answer was ouch. That's the last thing
ouch
Ed said at the end of Empire Strikes Back. But yeah, thanks for that email. That's awesome, buddy.
So thanks, Internet. It's been a blast and a really good episode, I feel. So I hope you guys enjoy it, too. As long as you guys keep listening, we'll keep doing this nerdy thing we do. Thanks again, Internet.
Stay nerdy, my friends, and watch more Muppets.
Yeah.
If you'd like to find out more about us, you can always check us out on Facebook at facebook.com/aplayonnerds.
Or check us out on Twitter and Instagram at aplayonnerds.
We're also streaming live game content all the time on twitch.tv/aplayonnerds.
Fun videos and stuff to check out, youtube.com/aplayonnerds.
And also please subscribe to us on iTunes and leave a review if possible, because that lets us be easily searched in the iTunes search index for podcasts.
And that way we know if we stink.
Exactly. Let us know if you hate us or you love us. That's always great.
Check us out at our website, www.aplayonnerds.com, where all this content can be found at the tip of your fingers.
And you can also always email us at anything@aplayonnerds.com.
And then check us out on, I guess, Snapchat, maybe.
For dick pics.
Or Tumblr.
Tumblr. Periscopes.
You could also throw a rock at us with a message on it.
Carrier pigeons.
We accept cassette tapes.
I love cassette tapes.
We just want to hear from you.
Yes, please send us anything you like at any social media outlets.
However you do it, check us out.
And how.
So I am currently recording. Steve, are you recording?
I'm recording, guys.
Yep. Oh, yes. Wait. Let me just. I said yes, and I am leading a triple check.
This is exactly why we do this check.
Yes. I'm Doc Hopper.
So German, what were your initial thoughts on this one? Because my prediction. Whoa. Wow, she's so mad.
Someone doesn't like Muppet Take Manhattan.
Ooh.
I'm Doc Hopper.